thank you very much for getting me on. I'm glad to be a part of this fellowship. And I want to take the opportunity to wish Pastor Surbhakti on his birthday. glad to be a part of this day. God bless you, sir.
Thank you.
And many more years to come. And it's a good day to be online on his birthday. Praise the name of the Lord. All right. So before I go any further, I want to pray. And if you can join me in a word of prayer, we can agree that God is going to speak to us. And it'll be an amazing time, I believe, and pray. So can we just look to the Lord and pray and say, Lord, speak to us even this evening or whatever time it may be in your particular time zone. Excuse me. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, we just want to bless you. We want to praise you. We want to worship you. We want to give you the glory. We want to ask you today that you will indeed speak to us. We need to hear your voice. And that's the reason, Lord, why we are here. We are here that we will hear you distinctly and clearly. Speak to us today. Let Jesus alone be glorified. Let Jesus alone be magnified, even today. And I pray in the name of Jesus, Father, that whatever we are going to share today will impact somebody, will touch somebody's life, and we will never be the same again. Holy Spirit, we acknowledge your presence. You are our teacher, you are our guide. And therefore, Lord, I pray you'll work in me, work through me, work in every person who's hearing this message. In the awesome name of Jesus, we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. All right. I'm going to be sharing today about what we see. And before we do that, let me do the honors of thanking every person being a part of this meeting. Just wanted to introduce myself very briefly. My name is Sandeep Daniel, and I basically right now am in Bangalore. But I was working for Malaysian Airlines back in Chennai, and later I was transferred to Bangalore, where I was working as the station manager, excuse me, of Malaysian Airlines in Bangalore. And then prior to my working as the station manager in Malaysian Airlines, I had told the Lord the day He touched my life, that is many years ago when I was in my 20s. I told the Lord I would serve Him on a full-time basis. But the Lord had to wait for many, many years. And then when I became the manager of Malaysian Airlines in Bangalore, He nudged me to remind me that I had promised Him that I would serve Him and on a full-time basis. And therefore, heeding to the invitation and the call of God on my life, I quit this airline company. And now I'm a full-time preacher. So I travel places. Of course, COVID-19 has stopped us from justly traveling, but thank God for these kind of opportunities the Lord has brought in my life. And therefore, I'm a combination of a person who did not know Christ, messed up life, and I've learned from that to come to a place where I begin to learn about the Lord, and the Lord gave me a job at Malaysian Airlines and started traveling. And the third stage in my life is what I'm right now, growing. I don't think we'll ever stop growing, but a full-time preacher. So my life can be divided into three segments, and I'm so glad God is a faithful God. And now I'm a full-time preacher. I know how the Lord has worked, will work, only if we reach out to Him by faith. And that being said, I want to thank God for another opportunity to share amongst great men and women of God. I'm humbled to be even part of this meeting. I don't boast about anything except for the grace of God in my life. And whatever the Lord has done in my life is amazing, and all the glory goes to Him. And so having said that, as an introduction, if you want to know more, we have our website, sandeepdaniel.org. We have a YouTube channel filled with a lot of videos I believe will help people. And so I come with this combination. I'm able to articulate certain issues a little better, because I've worked for the secular company for many, many years with Malaysian Airlines. So I know what it is to be a part of the world system and to also to be a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a very different tension. A person in the full-time ministry alone may not understand. Because now I'm full-time, I understand that tension better because I was working in the secular field. So with all this combination, we do have some very good topics, which I believe God has used me to bless the body of Christ with. that these words will encourage people. And that's the reason I do this. And please do check out my YouTube channel and my website. And I've got an app on the Google Play Store. Simply type Sandeep Daniel. You can download the app. So that's all about me. I'm not going to say anything more, just as a matter of introduction. Today, what I want to share with you is of primary importance, because I've realized that in this journey of life, we will start at a certain point and finish at a certain point in life, in this time zone. God, who sits outside of time, has given us a countdown timer in life, and he makes us to be birthed at a certain place and a certain time, and then we exit out of this earth at a certain place and a certain time. And this is the way the Lord works. He always takes us out of time, and he puts us into time, and he takes us back out of time. And so every person who's come into this world has come with an assignment, has come with something very important. Because why would God even bring us into this time zone? That is a question we must ask ourselves. And as a result of asking this question, you will come to realize that God is not a God who just wants us to at haphazardly bring us to this earth and at one point of time take us out. No, he's got a very specific plan. And I've been talking about time and time management in so many different forums, and including, you know, my YouTube channels, we have a lot of messages on time management. But I personally believe the very reason the Lord has put us into this time zone is that he has given us an assignment. He's given us a job to be done. The greatest tragedy is not death. The greatest tragedy is time being wasted, because time has got no value. It is immeasurable in terms of value. But because the Lord has brought us into this world and he expects us to finish a certain job, and then he exits us out of this earth in back into timelessness. So if you look at the words of Apostle Paul, at one point of time, he says, you know what? I think I love to go and be with the Lord. I'm paraphrasing here. He says, I love to be with the Lord, but for better reasons, I desire to stay with you. And so the Bible tells us that he kind of spoke as if he had his reins over time, that he didn't want to leave at that point of time. He said, I've got to be here and finish something. And again, you go to the book of Philippians, he says, you know what? The time of my departure is at hand, and I want to go. And he says, you know what? I finished my job. I completed my race. And whatever assignment has been laid up for me, it is complete. And therefore, every man, every woman, every human being born on this planet Earth, he comes with an assignment, and he has to complete his assignment, like Apostle Paul when he said, my time is up. I've completed my course. I finished my race. And that was the assurance that he departed. So when is a good time for us to leave the earth? Very good answer. When you finish your assignment, when I finish my assignment. So having said that as a backdrop, even Jesus, for that matter, when he hung on the cross of Calvary and he says, it is finished. When he cried, tetelestai, it is finished. What was he saying? He's saying that, you know, my job, the assignment on my life is complete. So that's when he said, it is finished, tetelestai. And he left, he breathed his last, handed his spirit over to his father, and then he moved on. And then the Bible, of course, we know the story. The third day he rose again from the dead. So every single one of us have come with this assignment, and it's so very important that we get a glimpse of this assignment. If we don't get a glimpse of this assignment, we are in trouble. Because it's only when you, whatever you see, is you're going to go and to that direction to which you see. So having said that, let me just quickly go to a portion of scripture which will help us to bring to life as to what I'm trying to tell you. The book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, reading from verse number 17, or maybe we can pick it up from verse number 16 for the sake of context. The book of 2 Corinthians chapter number 4, reading from verse number 16. Now he starts by saying, we're not going into the history of the case, but picking it up from verse number 16, he says, therefore, we do not lose heart. So we don't have the liberty of time to get back to what the therefore stands for. But we're just going to move on from this point. Excuse me. Therefore, we do not lose heart. What he was saying is, There are going to be seasons in life. There are going to be arsenals pointed against us that can distort our vision. Because you know what? One of the things the devil knows is that he cannot stop us from getting to a place, because God is backing us up. But one thing he can do is to distort our vision, put a smoke screen in front of us that we lose the focus of where we are going. So today my question would be this: do you know where you're going? Do you see, or what do you see? If you ask me, what do you see? I see things very clearly. Though there is a COVID-19 situation, though there's a pandemic, though there are job losses, though there are economic downturns, though there are corporations crumbling, though I see people's lives being lost, I see. Do you see? I see very well. I see what I'm assigned to do. I see what I'm called to do. I see the results of what I'm doing. I know that it's not being proud. It's being clear as to where I'm going. So if I know where I'm going with assurance, nothing can stop us. So the Apostle Paul says these words: we do not lose heart. So the question is, is it possible to lose heart? Yes, it is very possible for us to lose heart if we don't understand this one spiritual dynamic I want to talk about, which is vision, sight. What do you see? And it's only when you see can you go somewhere. So he says, we do not lose heart. And then he says, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. In other words, in the spiritual clock, we need to get better. We need to get stronger. That's why he says, the inward man is being renewed day by day. Our outward man may be getting older. That's not even in the context here. We're talking about the inner man. The inner man must get better every single day. The inner man must get better. And then he says in verse 17, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment. So whatever that has gone wrong with our lives, whatever the world has presented to you and me, the Apostle Paul uses the word light affliction. And by the way, if you really want to go into the life of Apostle Paul and see that whatever difficulties he's been through, I don't know how many people can really say, I've suffered like Paul. There could be people like that, but I can tell you, I've not suffered the way Paul suffered. Physically beaten, naked, hungry, his own people betraying him, beaten close to death. All these things are, experiences, and the man can call it light affliction. Light affliction. What moves you and what moves me? Does the 50% job reduction in our salary shake us and move us? Do we crumble and fall like a pack of cards when we hear of some small issue that happens in our life? Are we blown away like a pack of cards in the wind when we hear about some bad news? Or are we like Apostle Paul? He says, for our light affliction, he says after going through all these things, but it is for a moment. It is for a moment. Notice this. What he's saying is, this particular light affliction, whatever we are going through, is for a moment and is working for us. So if you are in Christ and if I am in Christ, all he's saying is, everything that is so-called working against us, it seems like that, is actually working for us. I was watching one of the Facebook posts the other day, and it was very interesting. It is like Jesus and the devil having a conversation, right? This is just a meme. And in that it says, the devil says, you know what? I closed all your churches. And Jesus responds back, said, you're right. You closed all our churches, but I opened a church in every home. That's what it's all about. So the Bible says, these afflictions are working for us for a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. In other words, everything is propelling us to eternal destiny. So my life on this earth is just nothing but a projection to eternal glory. So everything that we must do, everything that we must say, our breath on this world, everything has a weight of significance, not in this present world. Though, yes, we have to cause an impact here, but the real impact is actually on eternity, because the work that we are doing here is eternal in its impact. Now we come to the main verse. Now the question is, Paul, how can you say things like that? You're calling it light affliction. You're calling it just for a moment. And then you're telling me on top of this, it's working for me. Where do you come from? Aren't you a part of this world? Don't you know the job losses? Don't you know Corona-19 and COVID-19 has killed multiple people? Don't you realize that jobs are being lost? The Apostle Paul will still stick to what he said and says, it's a light affliction. It is just for a moment. And then it says, it's working for us for a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Okay, now, having said that as an introduction, I need to stop and find out what made Apostle Paul say that. What was he seeing? Because he uses the word, for a light affliction is but for a moment, is working for us far more an eternal weight of glory. And I must ask him, what do you see for you to say things like this? By the way, I want to, before I go to verse 18, I want to tell us, whatever you see, you will speak. And that's a very important statement I'm making here. Whatever it is that you see is what you will speak. Jesus said these words, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you're speaking something, it's about what you have seen it. That's why you speak it. If you're saying to me or so, telling anybody around you, oh, I'm afraid of what this COVID is going to do to me. Oh, I'm afraid of what will happen tomorrow. Oh, I'm afraid. You've seen something and that's why you're speaking it. So therefore, I want to urge you today is what you see is what you will speak. So if you're seeing right, you will speak right. If you don't see right, you're going to speak wrong. Very, very simple. So now we are going to go back into some detailed examination in a couple of minutes to find out how the Apostle Paul can actually say what he said. And before, we'll go right there. The book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse number 18. Now watch this, please. While we do not look at the things that are seen, but at the things which are not seen. So now I need to categorize. There are two important things that you can see. The first set of things that you can see is the things which are called not seen or unseen. I mean, that's one where you can pitch your eyes on. The second thing, the second set of items that you can actually see is the things that which you cannot see. So there's something things you can see. There are some things you cannot see. Okay, now listen, hang in there very carefully. The Bible says we do not look at the things that are seen, but at the things which are not seen. So in other words, he's telling us you are also given two sets of eyes. The first set of eyes is called physical eyes. With the physical eyes, you can see physical things. All right, you see me, you see myself. Right now I'm talking to you. So God says he gives you the set of eyes, physical eyes, to be able to see the seen things. But he also says, God has given us what is called the spiritual eyes to see things which are invisible. Invisible to who? Invisible to the natural eyes. So listen to me very carefully. With my natural eyes, I can see what is natural. With my natural eyes, I cannot see the unseen because the unseen is hidden from the natural eyes. But therefore, the Lord gives us another set of eyes to be able to see the things which cannot be seen by the natural eyes. And I hope I'm not confusing you, but let me read that verse one more time. For we do not look at the things which are seen. In other words, you need to make a choice to see what God wants to show you. Let me explain that. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. So in other words, the Lord is telling us, you use the other set of eyes, the spiritual eyes, to see the things which are unseen. Okay, now, where are we going with this? Let me explain. Right, watch this. For the things which are seen are temporal. So anything that you can see, anything that is temporal, the Bible says, will vanish one day because it's temporal. But the things which are not seen are eternal. That's simply amazing. So the Apostle Paul is teaching us that there are two sets of eyes and two sets of things that can be seen. First of all, natural things you can see. I can see you, you can see me. So he says, do not look at those things because those things that you can see, physically see, will one day evaporate, one day disintegrate. For example, we see the world. This world is not going to be around for too very long. I'm not giving you the date or the time. I'm just telling you, Jesus said these words, heaven and earth will pass away. All right. So the things that we see will disappear, will vanish one day. But the things which are not seen are eternal. So what are the things that are not seen? That's a very important question to ask. So the Apostle Paul, once he got a hold of this vision, his spiritual sight, to be able to see things which are in the unseen realm or in the eternal realm, he began to speak differently. He says light affliction, temporal, not a problem. And he began to say, this is actually working for my good. I mean, Paul, what are you saying? Because he is seeing something else apart from what the natural man sees. This is a secret and this is a key. So today, if you want to be successful, it's all a matter of vision. What do you see? What do you see? Okay, by the way, I need to explain one small terminology in this passage of scripture. He says, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I want you to look at the words not seen, invisible, not seen, unseen. These are the words which are used. It will never say at any point of time things which do not exist. No, it simply says not seen. For example, if I talk to you about, I mean, you can see me, but do you see the room behind where I am? You don't see it. But just because you don't see the room behind me in the studio doesn't mean the room does not exist. It's just that you are not able to see it. It doesn't mean it does not exist. Say, for example, if you have a dog, a pet dog, right? And I come to your home and then you call your pet dog by whatever name. You call the dog Jimmy or whatever it may be, and you call your pet dog by name. You say, Jimmy, come here. And I come to your house, who are you talking to? And you tell me you're talking to Jimmy. I say, hello, who's Jimmy? He says, Jimmy is my dog. So I don't see Jimmy. But doesn't mean that Jimmy is non-existent. It simply means Jimmy is not visible to you. So, but if I hang on a little while longer, and if you keep calling for Jimmy, Jimmy comes in and then he appears from the unseen realm to the seen realm. And then I say, wow, I see it. Excuse me. So my point here is this. You see, a person with an excellent vision, spiritual vision, can see beyond the natural into the supernatural. Once you see that, the world, the problems of this world, nothing is going to shake you, because you're going to talk like Apostle Paul. This is temporal. This is nothing. It's actually working for my good. It's temporal. But the things we are talking about is eternal. God is the eternal realm. And therefore, anything to do with God, it cannot be seen by the natural man. The spiritual man can perceive the things of the spirit. Having said that, I just want to quickly go to maybe one or two scriptures to prove to us how important it is for us to begin to see what God has called us to see. The book of Matthew, chapter number 9, we're going to read one portion of scripture and then slowly bring it to a close. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9, we're going to read from verse number 27 onwards. And my Bible heading says, two blind men healed. Two blind men healed. Okay, watch this, please. Very, very interesting words. When Jesus departed from there, give me a second. I'll get to that verse in a moment. Yeah. When Jesus departed from there, two blind men followed him, crying out and saying, Son of David, have mercy on us. Son of David, have mercy on us. Now watch this. Now remember, two of them were blind. All right. So their faculty of sight was null and void. They could not see. But they had spiritual sight. What do I mean by saying spiritual sight? Notice, when Jesus walked on planet Earth, on the shores of Galilee, only a few people had the insight that he was the Son of God. Many people thought him just to be a prophet. Some people said he is from the devil. The Pharisees accused him that the miracles he's doing is of Beelzebub. And so not everybody had the revelation that Jesus was the Son of God or the Son of David, speaking about his actual name as revealed in the scriptures in the Old Testament. But these two blind men, the Bible says, they followed him. First of all, they followed him and cried out to him, saying, you see, when you follow Jesus, our spiritual eyes will begin to open. The key is to follow him. You see, the Bible said these words in the book of John, my sheep will hear my voice. And that's what the Lord said. If you are the sheep of God, you will follow him. You will hear his voice. So these two blind men, though they were physically blind, they followed him because the Bible says They knew something in their heart that Jesus had the answer to my question. So let me just let you know, first of all, a person who follows Jesus seriously will be able to have spiritual sight. And that's very important for life itself. And I want to tell you about how, when we have a spiritual sight open, things will happen. I mean, imagine you're able to see through the smoke screen. And I want to tell you that technology today, you see, when you fly an aeroplane, as a matter of fact, I told you I was working for Malaysian Airlines. So I've had the privilege of sitting in the cockpit many times and flying. There's a third seat in the cockpit called the jump seat. And I, being the airport manager, I was given the privilege of being able to sit in that seat and see the captains fly the plane. And many a time I used to sit there, look at what they're doing. And when the flight takes off at midnight, 11:30 at night, the flight takes off and you see nothing. Pitch black, nothing in front of you. But the captain, may I add, he's not so-called flying the plane, just looking at the sky and all that. No, no, no. His eyes are on the dials. His eyes are on the numbers. His eyes are on the voice that he's hearing from the control tower. You know, that's who he's flying the plane. Not with his natural eyes, really, in that sense. Because when he looks at it, it's all pitch black. But he's hearing the voice of the ground. He's hearing the voice of the control tower saying, maintain this altitude, turn this altitude, turn right, turn left to this particular heading and all that stuff. So in the same way, here the revelation is for us to, first of all, follow Jesus, not by our sensory knowledge, following Jesus. And the Bible says they followed him and cried and said, Son of David, have mercy on us. They addressed him as the Son of David. They were blind, but they had the spiritual sensitivity open. Though they were physically blind, they were spiritually, their eyes were open. And the Bible says, and when he had come into the house, the blind man came to him. The second reason how I can get my eyes open, spiritual eyes open, is to follow Jesus. Follow wherever he goes. Take the trouble to follow him. And today, how do I follow Jesus? Today, the way we follow Jesus is to hear his word. It is simple as that. Romans chapter 10, verse, I believe, is 17. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. If we want to grow in faith, it's constantly getting the word inside our heart. If you keep getting faith in your heart, we will never miss it. And this is what it means to follow Jesus. And the Bible says, and Jesus said to them, do you believe that I'm able to do this? Today, my friend, the question is this. Once you get a vision, a revelation beyond this natural life into something to eternity, and you see the King of Glory seated in all his majesty, all his power, and you forget all of the smoke screen the world has to bring, and the spiritual sight will be able to give you the spiritual caliber, the spiritual vision to be able to see through that, to see the glory of God. I'm telling you, this world is a breeze. We can live in this world in spite of the difficult times. God has promised great things for us. I mean, it may sound impossible, but that's what Jesus lived. He proved to us that in this world, there will be tribulation, he says. But he says, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And we are overcomers in the name of Jesus Christ. And Jesus asked them this question. Do you believe I am able? Do you believe I am able? And if you say, yes, Lord, just like these blind men said, he touched their eyes. Now watch this. Thankfully, their spiritual eyes was open, and then their natural eyes needed a touch from Jesus. He touched their eyes, saying, oh, this is the key, according to your faith, be it unto you. Many times we are asking the Lord, Lord, let your faith work in my life. Lord, I need this. Please give it to me. The Lord says, you know what? The actual quantum of reception is not me giving it to you. It's how much do you have the capacity to receive? Do you have the capacity to receive? He says, I have no problem of supplying that need, but do you have the capacity to receive? And the Bible says, Lord, the Bible says, according to your faith, then he says, and their eyes were opened, verse 30, and their eyes were opened, and Jesus told them, don't tell anyone, and that's not in the topic, we'll just leave it at that. But my point here is that they began to see. Another place where the same thing happens is in the story of blind Bartimaeus. He says, Son of David, have mercy on me. Man was blind. The man was blind, but his spiritual sensitivity was open. His eyes were open. He called him, "Son of David, have mercy on me." You see, today, the key is, what are we seeing? What are we seeing? What is that? If I ask you a question, what do you see? What is that you see? Do you see your difficult problems, your situations, your problem here? You know, I know all of us live in this world with problems and concerns. The Apostle Paul is not talking about no problems. He says, in spite of the problem, it's light affliction, because I see through these problems, through eternity, into the Lord who's seated high and lifted up, and his train fills the temple. The glory of God is all around us. It's just that we need to see. And this is the way you can see. I'm going to close with one last verse, and then I'll be out of your way. The book of Ephesians, chapter number 5 and verse number 14. Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 14. This is the Apostle Paul with great burden talking to the church at large. And I echo with this sentiment, because this is the words of the Apostle Paul with very much of a burden. He says, "Awake, you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light." What was he saying? He was not talking about somebody sleeping in the church. He's talking about a setup which happened in those days, in that church itself. There was this form of religiosity, but it lacked the depth. It lacked the maturity. It lacked the fortitude to be able to see and walk in that true maturity of Christ. You know, he is talking to a set of people who did everything possible. They sang in the church, they worshiped God, they did everything right. But when the storms of life came, they crumbled and fell like a pack of cards. And he was talking to that church and saying, you know, church, I mean, you had everything going your way. You have, you know, the power of Christ is working in your life. The gifts of the Spirit are available. But how come you're sleeping? He's not referring to sleeping naturally. He was talking about spiritual lethargy, where their vision was so short-sighted that they were only living for that particular day, not for the intention and purpose of God in their life. And I pray this is going to be our prayer today, that Lord, open my eyes to the magnitude of your splendor, not just for that today, not just for the small thing that I do today. No, God has called me for bigger things. He says, "Awake, who you sleep, arise from the dead." He's talking about a dead situation, breathing dead. But I'm going to tell you, if you were able to see through the smoke screen into the glory of God with that spiritual eyes, which must be opened, and I'm telling you, we'll be able to see. I know there's problems in this world. Jesus said so, and I agree with the Lord. I agree with people who go through trouble, but I'm telling you, you'll be able to see through the storms into the glory of God. And the Bible says, and Christ will give you light. Christ will give you light. When you see through the storm, through the light of Christ, seated high and lifted up, I'm telling you, that vision will change your life. On the road to Damascus, the man who was breathing threatenings against the church, Saul, when he encountered and saw that light, his life was changed instantaneously. And his vision completely changed because he had encounter with the true and the living God. If you have an encounter with the Lord, you'll never be the same again. This world system cannot threaten you. Sickness cannot put you down. This world's issues cannot, you know, torment you. You'll rise above these storms, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And therefore I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you will begin to get this message and the principles of this message, to be able to look not just to what we see through that. And for that, our spiritual eyes must be open. And the opening of that eyes is with a revelation of this Holy Spirit in his word. So with these words, I want to say thank you. May God richly bless you. And I pray in the name of Jesus that this message will somehow impact you or the other. And I'm recording this message. I will send it to Pastor Sulbakti. And if I was very fast, very sorry, that's why I recorded. You can go back, check it out. And God richly bless you. Back to Pastor.